Hey, what's up, everybody? I know everybody loves a good debate, and there is one going on around lats, although I'd argue it's not really a debate because most of them are agreeing with each other like 90%, and I'm just over here like, what are you guys doing? But I figured since I have Wade here, I could provide you guys some visuals to go along with some of the comments that have been made regarding the leverage of the lats and being them overhead and what they look like at different angles, etc. And, you know, kind of give you a little bit of what we talk about, you know, when we teach biomechanics. But very simple, what we're looking at here is that we have a green, red, and a purple band coming up here underneath the arm. And this represents the upper division of the lats, the thoracic division, the lumbar, which is the middle division, and then the iliac division, which is the most low and anterior fibers of the lats, right? So this discussion came about in a combination with the post from Chris Beardsley, Paul Carter, Mike Israetel, and now even a video from Lyle McDonald, you know, who just likes to disagree with all of them, apparently, even me, you know, accusing me of saying things that I didn't even say. By the way, Lyle, this is me. Hi, I'm me. I'm not any of those other people. So the stuff they said, please don't say that I said it. Thank you very much. Anyway, so what they're discussing is the change in the lever or moment arm that these fibers have as this arm starts to come up. So basically what you need to understand is the more these fibers are perpendicular to the humerus, the better they are going to be at this shoulder extension, right? So shoulder extension is this motion here, okay? Now, the first one that kind of loses its mechanical advantage for extension is the upper division, because basically these fibers are starting to become parallel with the humerus as we're getting closer to 90 degrees. Not quite, but they're getting to the point where they don't have as much of an extension vector, but these guys still have quite a bit. Now what happens as the arm starts to go up, this insertion point starts to go back towards the axis. So that means that these guys are going to start becoming more and more parallel with the humerus. So basically the principle here is, in terms of these guys having, least, especially this guy here, the most low division, in terms of it having leverage for being good at shoulder extension, right, the higher we go, basically past 90 degrees, the more that starts to drop off. So, you know, like right here, these guys got really good leverage, still pretty decent leverage, kind of some leverage. And then here it's like, all right, now these fibers would be doing more what we would call glenohumeral translation. So that would basically be pulling the humerus down. So here you can see this orange fiber here, when it loses its mechanics for extension, its main role here would be pulling the shoulder back, which if you think of it, if you were doing a row out this way, that would be participation of those lat fibers to pull the shoulder back, right? And these guys would be initiating the extension. So when you look at all the stuff back here, it's all kind of working simultaneously, but what role it has and how much of a role it has will vary depending on the angle your arm is at, both this way, how much it's coming across the body, et cetera, whether or not it's using the rib cage as like an anatomical pulley, et cetera. So as we start to go up, what happens is the lower divisions of the lats start having more of a translation function and less of an extension function. And once we get up here, their extension function is very poor, but their, you know, their translation function is almost now 100% of their force, right? So basically, if you have to think of it, you can think of it this way, is that there will always be a ratio of, if this is pulling, how much is it pulling and it's rotating the humerus in extension versus how much is it just pulling the humerus down? And so when it has good leverage, it's doing the extension more than it is pulling the humerus down. When it doesn't have good leverage, it's pulling the humerus down more than it's extending. Now, how does that translate to exercise and what exercises that we would choose to load these fibers, et cetera, right? So, sorry, Wade's losing pieces over here. He needs some surgery. Anyway, so for these fibers here, they're really gonna be the dominant ones for extending the shoulder when we're way back here. Okay, these guys here are going to be more dominant extending the shoulder when we are loaded somewhere in here. So if you think of, you know, what would be pulling up right here, well, that would be a pull down with the cable like out in front of you. These guys would be really advantageous. A higher, you know, cable pull, these guys would still be pretty good. As we start to get up here, right, if there's a pulley pulling me out, these guys would still be doing a tiny bit of extension, but mostly translation, which means that in terms of the extension, they would be requiring a little bit more help from maybe some of the posterior delts, the teres, and even elbow flexion contributing to driving the humerus down this way, because you're gonna have something this way. So if I can use my elbow flexors to push down like this so that these guys can get a bit of leverage, all of that's gonna happen in a nice coordinated muscle contraction for that movement, so that basically whoever is the most efficient can be doing more of the work. So when we're looking at challenging these fibers, then obviously if we're loading them through extension, then we wanna have something that is gonna be pulling the arm this way. But when we look at, we'll say, like, I think the dumbbell pullover was one of the exercises that came about in this discussion. So with the dumbbell, right, the difference between that and say a pull down, this is that in a pull down, you're still having the arm pulled this way, which means these guys are gonna be loaded by basically resisting the arm being pulled up. So their translation function is still in play, but their ability to extend the humerus is much more limited. So that means, you know, what's my nervous system gonna do? Is it gonna use the thing that is really crappy at the job, or is it gonna use things that are more, or is it just gonna try and get everybody on board to help? So if the arm is being pushed this way by a dumbbell, right, like it's overhead or something like that, as I turn here, this is where the pec thing comes in. So the pec actually has a better vector to do this initial portion of shoulder extension when the arm is like way back up here, okay? And then you're also gonna have more of the scapular muscles involved in that as well. So essentially in a dumbbell, this is the hardest portion of holding that dumbbell, right? Like when it's back here, that's when the dumbbell is providing the most resistance, but it's also when our lats have, we'll say, will be biased the least over all of the things that are acting at the shoulder. So if you compared that to a cable pullover, where maybe the cable was like just pulling slightly up, but it was still pulling this, the arm this way, well, a cable's gonna load the translation part, so the lats are gonna be involved to a greater degree in a cable pullover than a dumbbell pullover likely. It's actually a lab that I have not run as the comparison of all the pullovers, because I don't have a pullover machine yet. And with the pullover machine, what the pullover machine does is it basically makes this a fixed point, so it eliminates the whole translation portion from it. And that's one of the reasons that I rank that lower when it comes down to training lat exercises, is like I would rather do a pull down or a row that loads the extension but also includes the translation of the humerus, because I'm going to get more range of motion, and just overall that motion and the recruitment is going to be more biased to lats. That is something that we've looked at, is basically when we remove the translation, we tend to do a lot more work with the just shoulder extension, like the teres and the posterior delts, and even the elbow flexors tend to get involved in a little bit more if we isolate that movement like this. But if we're doing something like this, we tend to see just the, we'll say, dedicated shoulder extensors tend to do a little bit more work than the lats. But if we keep that translation component in, it gets better. So I just think, you know, if your goal is just to try and figure out which one of these is going to be more ideal as a lat exercise, I think, you know, your things where you're including the translation component and the elbow extension or the shoulder extension component are going to be your best options. Now, the thing that like people are getting nitpicky about is, well, do the lats do zero once you get to a certain point? Do they just then do nothing? And the answer is, well, no, they don't do nothing. There's a difference between a muscle doing nothing versus a muscle contributing very poorly to actually like moving and overcoming the resistance. So in this position, are the lats gonna be doing nothing? No, they're gonna be working, but the amount of tension in that muscle is doing very little to extend the arm. So what your brain's gonna do is it's gonna try and contract things in the most efficient way possible. That means using the things that have good leverage and not using the things that have poor leverage. So, and this is something that we see consistently when we're kind of looking at, you know, the coordination of, you know, motor patterns as we do different exercises. The things that are in that path of motion or have leverage there tend to be recruited the most, and other things tend to go down. So if you're in this position, are the lats gonna be doing zero? No. Are they gonna be doing less if a dumbbell is pushing this way than if I had something pulling this way? Yes, because you're not loading the translation component as much. So if I have to summarize up the people that were debating this, what Paul was saying was basically that, okay, because these guys are no longer good extensors of the shoulder, doing a motion where it's basically loading only the extension component would be, you know, bad for lats. I think, you know, maybe in his post he said zero lats or whatever, which, you know, I mean, being pedantic, to be honest, like, it can never be zero because these things would have to be parallel to the axis, which would mean they would actually have to come in, you know, inside the humerus essentially, or like in between the space there or along the outside, neither of which of those is really going to happen in a live human that has the arm still attached. So the moment arm, there will always be some moment arm. It's just that it gets to a point where it's not very efficient at all. And that's where you're going to have to compensate and use a lot of other tissue. So could you make better exercise selection? Yes. Is it correct to say it's zero lats? No. Is it correct to say that, like, well, the lats are still going to be, you know, doing a ton of work there? That's stretching it. They're probably, you know, and especially in a dumbbell thing, they're probably not going to be doing a lot. And that's why what research there is, including ours in the house, shows that the EMG activity of the lats in that position is fairly small and minimal. And we tend to see more in the chest, more in the shoulder or the scapulohumeral muscles like the teres and the posterior delts. Now, Dr. Mike's position was, well, because coming up here is stretching these, it's still good for hypertrophy because you're getting the stretch benefit, right? And so, you know, we do have research suggesting that, yeah, there is something about that stretch position that seems to be beneficial for hypertrophy. Likely that has something to do with how Titan comes in and contributes to the whole, you know, hypertrophy signaling process. So that's when we're getting into the point where there's that passive tension on the tissue, or just more of the, we'll say, you know, connective based mechanical tension on that tissue. So my comment to Mike is that basically it's like, okay, if you could go up here in a position where essentially you are getting a stretch here, but it's really poor at the extension, why would we not get more of a stretch by actually just using a narrower position, which this, if you can't tell, is stretching the lats this way. So it uses the rib cage, especially when you factor in that, you know, this has some girth to it, some muscle tissue, etc., right, as we come around. So if you stretch the lats here, and what you'll find is if you simply just bring your arm across and then you try and lift it, it's like you get to a lat stretch earlier than if you are out here. Very simple. Come across there, lats are stretched. So here, if I can get the stretch, but I'm also still in a good position, like in terms of my mechanics as being shoulder extensors, and now I were to load a pole, well, I get the benefit of the stretch-mediated hypertrophy, and I also get the mechanical tension from the, you know, the contractile portion, right? So the actin and myosin actually pulling on each other because they're going to get a lot of stimulus. Like, this is going to signal well, right? And you're going to see a lot of lat activity in that motion. So it's, to me, that's the best case scenario if we're talking about, like, which one of those would be the best way to load, you know, get the stretch benefit and, you know, the mechanical tension from the contraction portion of it. Now, I think Mike's argument with that is that this is just, these exercises are just too complicated. And that, I mean, that's a judgment call on your part, right? Like, I mean, if you, obviously if you use like narrow handles and you just do something here, that's not super complicated. If you're doing single arm stuff where you're coming way across the body, then yeah, there's more to the nuances of that technique than there is just, you know, letting a handle pull your arms overhead. So, I mean, you can make that debate of how complex do you want the exercise to be? But I mean, really, you know, that's, you know, I guess you could say preference, or just like, you know, is it worth then learning to just do good exercise as well or whatever? That's, you know, that's a opportunity cost benefit thing that you can work out. I'm not gonna continue going on that. And then I think Lyle's biggest problem was that he doesn't like any of us. And also that somebody said zero moment arm or zero whatever. And, you know, and he's just going, I mean, he goes through like what the research and stuff says, but okay. So this is to answer one of Lyle's questions that he had in his video, because he looked at the actual papers, and in one of the papers it shows a greater moment arm for the lats than the other, but it doesn't actually come past 80 degrees, which would be about here. And I don't know for sure this is it, but that's exactly what we see if we are modeling people that have varying distances of insertion here. And so the thing he says is that, well, he doesn't think it would approach zero as it was coming up towards 120. And what I would tell Lyle is, I think you're wrong there. I think it's still going to approach that, because as the arm comes up, this is gonna have to get parallel to this, right? And what happens is this stuff, like if you imagine that this was stuck way out here, right? At the insertion point, I'm just exaggerating this, right? But if this was way further out, it's like, well, okay, this has a much longer lever now than when it was back here close to the red guy. But as the arm comes up, it will still get to the point where it is close to zero, right? And it will do so at relatively the same point, okay? The only way to actually change the fact that all once it gets like, basically once it gets past, if you imagine this is an arc and like 80 degrees is actually probably where this would have had its biggest moment, right? You know, it just kind of depends on where they were taking the measure. And I think in the particular study that referenced, it didn't divide up. So it used probably something close to this red line, right? So probably more appropriately to move this like a little further out here, and that would say, okay, this is gonna be greater here, right? And so it was probably then probably closer to 60 degrees, I think, which probably matches up with what its peak would have been, right? But as it comes up here, as it starts to end up on that other side of the arc and we start getting closer to 120, it's still going to come back in close to the axis. And so even though it had better leverage in that mid position, if they were to actually have done that study up to 120, it still would have gotten close to zero-ish, right? Now, what would impact where exactly this happens is gonna be the relationship between this axis and how far around these attachment points are, right? Because that's gonna affect when basically we have a parallel line between this guy, the shoulder joint, and the bone, right? So really it would be basically the further they move, the however they're measuring it, the further they move that anterior, the higher it would go before they would get to a quote near zero or more inefficient or extremely inefficient moment arm or lever for doing the shoulder extension. So hopefully that visual was helpful for you guys that were confused. Hopefully those nuances added some context for those of you guys that didn't know what to think with all of the, you know, the insults and crap that was being slinging. As you notice, I stayed out of that conversation as much as possible, and I just tried to contribute something beneficial, but I think it probably got lost in all of the drama. So yeah, that's basically it. So the lats become less efficient at shoulder extension as we start to go up. We can get to a stretch by adding in a adduction coming across in the front, and then we don't need as much shoulder extension to get that stretch in the lats, right? Especially if we're talking about the lumbar and the thoracic fibers, the upper fibers, they basically are only gonna get a stretch coming this way, because as the arm comes up this way, they're really not changing in length much at all as we're going into that extreme extension. And obviously their translation would be more backwards and not down. So, you know, loading up like this isn't loading their translation point very much, or their translation function very much, or their extension function very much. So when we're talking about these divisions of the lats, then all of this stuff up here is just, it's just a poor exercise selection choice. In general, we'd want to do things that were more pulling this way, so to speak, right? And then everything's, you know, gonna get shortened coming back here. So that was probably too much of a ramble. Tried to keep it short and sweet. Hopefully this looks good and shows up good. Sorry, I forgot my, or I don't have my mic today. So if it's a little echoey, I apologize. I'm sure somebody's already, you know, telling me in the comments that the audio sucks or whatever people like to complain about. Yeah, do whatever lat exercises that you want, but that's basically a quick rundown of why the lats are losing leverage as you start to get up overhead.